a crowded, cluttered library office space, whatever. And that's Mr. Alfie Montero from Pune. Alfie is the author of The Baddeskars, The Mystery of a Migration. I read your book, Alfie. I reviewed it. I was quite impressed by it because it tells us an aspect of Goa which we are not much aware of. Can you please introduce us to your book?
Yeah. In fact, because of your review in Navin Times, this book got very good publicity.
No, I won't take credit for it because yes. It's your work and it's a good book.
Yeah. And I realized that this Goan Catholics who migrated almost 300 years on the Ghats, unlike Mangaloreans or people from Savanpadi, who went by sea route, because that time sea route was more convenient for Goans to move away. But they took the land route, crossing the treacherous Sahyadri Ghats, and spread over almost 150 long strip from Kolhapur district to Karwar district to the south.
Just to clarify, your migration that you're talking about is Goans leaving Goa and going mostly northwards or at the most till Karwar, correct? Not the Mangaloreans, not the Mangalorean community.
Not the Mangaloreans, not the Karwars.
Okay.
It is just above the Ghats, on the Ghats.
Okay.
They are the people who were above the Ghats. So they were sort of cut off from the mainland Goa as well as with Mangalorean and other Karwar people.
And so they have ended up today in places all along, say, Maharashtra and
Karnataka.
Yeah. North Karnataka
and western part of Maharashtra, up to only Kolhapur district.
They are called the Baddeskars.
The reason was that, again, there is a slight variation. Northern part of Belgaum district, some Catholics adopted Baddeskar surname even for their revenue records.
It's part of their name?
Part of their name for revenue records.
Okay.
But in the church, they have the proper Catholic names and surnames. But middle of the Belgaum district, like Chandigarh, Azra, neighbors call them as Baddeskars. But they have their proper Catholic name, surname for revenue records as well as this.
When did this migration take place?
To my knowledge, it started from, say, 1667 to 1739. 1739, we have some proper record.
Why these dates? Why these, any reason for
these
dates?
See, in 1667, Shivaji invaded Goa in Bardes.
Bardes.
Just to punish the Desais who were not giving his Chautai or that and this, yeah, from Pedne, which was under this. And they, when Shivaji's people used to go there, they used to just fled to Portuguese area. To punish them, he invaded Bardes. And as per the record, even written by Pisurlekar and other things, around 1200 people he took as a captive. Among them, two were priests from Kolwan. It is on that road. So maybe some of these people have settled
there
on the Ghats. And the reason to believe is that my ancestors, Monteros, from Nesri, they say there is no this, but even I knew one piece of land and one small house was given to the widow who died during the war, Marathas with Mughals. So they used to call Sodi Talita, Sadi Cholita Maan.
That is the name of the land.
And
okay.
For the upkeep, means like Sadi means Sari,
yeah,
and this. It was given, that's what, and that place or that piece of land was with us in 1950. One of our ancestors sold it out because around 1860s we migrated to another place 10 kilometers away called Tiurwadi. We settled over there.
Which district? So, which taluka?
This is Changar taluka in Kolhapur district.
Kolhapur.
It is hardly 20. See, Kolhapur is almost 80-90 kilometers away, but Belgaum is hardly 20 kilometers.
I see.
Because of the dispute of border,
okay,
it has become that way. So that may be one reason. And another reason to link it, though I am trying to get the historical this, that we have a tradition called Almache Jevan.
Souls, the Feast of the Souls.
That is, it is having sanctity, divinity, and that that meal is served just a day before the nuptials.
Marriage.
And many people have fast in the morning, they serve vegetarian food, five vegetables or something. Though it is Goa, it is called Bikaranche Jevan, but we have very miss sanctity.
Yeah, it's treated much more seriously, and it's called Almache
Jevan. Yeah, Almache.
So it's also also part of the Indic tradition that we pay respect to our ancestors.
Yeah.
And we give them food, like it's a very Indian kind of tradition.
Yeah,
no.
Yeah. So it is an Indian tradition.
Yeah.
Like what they used to have in Hindus, they have a shraddh for the dead people or dead souls. So it's called Almache Jevan, and among all those 130 villages, people, all they serve vegetarian food, which shrimps, curry, five vegetables.
Odd number of vegetables.
Vegetables and one. It is a
one, of course. Jaggery is sweet, made of jaggery.
Gram and
gram.
That is there. But only in Monteros they have a mutton dish, one dish.
Non-veg.
Non-veg. So I used to wonder and asked why. Then they used to say one of our ancestors was a warrior and he died because his honor, this Monteros served him.
I see.
So that is that.
So warriors need the non-veg, the non-veg sustenance.
To honor that.
Okay, to honor.
So that may be the reason that 1667, because this war, this Sardar of Shivaji, Sir Senapati or Chief Commander, Pratap Rao Gujar, he had a fight with Mughals, Bahlul Khan, in 1674, near Nesri, where my ancestors were staying. And during that war, that Pratap Rao Gujar died over there, along with his seven companions.
There is a legend.
And his tomb is there near Nesri village. And we were in Nesri, and from there we migrated afterwards. So there may be some credence, and some are one or two Marathi or Hindu people have written in that they have mentioned that Monteros were in the Maratha army. But I don't think any historical reference or this. But whatever it may be, hearsay. So that is the
reason,
and maybe and that is the history also tells that 1667 he invaded Bardes.
Yeah, that's all on record. Yeah,
200 people he had taken as a captive. So maybe some of maybe.
So Mr. Montero, between then and now, what has been the connection between this community and Goa? Some memory has been revived. I mean, your book of course tells the full story.
Yeah,
but before that, were people aware?
They were aware. See what happened. For two, three reasons. Initially, there used to be no priest. See, to my days, maybe in Tiswadi or Ilas or Salset, Christianization started from 1950 onwards.
Yeah.
But in Bardes, it started only after 1600. There are hardly few stray cases.
Okay.
And that is, we have seen Santaram Ghatkar's book, Tombodi Aldona. He has given the minutes of the Comunidad people
meetings
from 1601 to 1605, which I have read it.
Yeah.
And there he has given the
in Marathi, this is Modi?
Actually, it was in Hal Kannada. Earlier.
Yeah.
That was a standard.
You know that?
That time. No, I don't know.
Okay.
But he translated in Devanagari script, Shantaram Ghat.
Ghatkar.
He translated. I read that book also in Central Library. And in that book, he has given the names of the Gaonkars who were present for the meeting, communal meeting. And out of 12, first 8 names are Catholic names, but father's name is Hindu.
Yeah, I noticed that even in Alan's book it comes up. So the father is Hindu and the son is Catholic.
Catholic.
So the transition is just happening.
Yeah, so and even Franciscan history, I'm having the book by she died.
Sharon DeCruz. Very nice lady,
yeah,
person.
Yeah, almost 400 pages are there. So then also she has this. So Christianization started only after around 1600 because Franciscans were a bit sluggish.
Yeah, the pattern was different. Yeah.
In fact, Archbishop befriended them, even the king also was there. So they started somewhere after 1600 or 1595 onwards.
Right.
They started. Yeah. And initially there is a resistance for
any
first generation. Conversion.
It's something very strange and alien.
Yeah, generation, particularly Portuguese were colonial powers, they wanted to establish, and so many other reasons for
cultural and cultural, ideological, whatever.
But the migration started with what I am saying is that after 1667, where Shivaji invaded, that time almost four generations were in Catholic faith. And why I am telling this? Because all our people, though they are away from mainland Goa, I think they have a lot of Portuguese words. In our days,
I see.
It is difficult. Now, you may be surprised or you may be, call it our culture of Irma and Mana. Even we address our elders, seniors, as Irma.
I see.
Irma means
brother.
And Mana means sister.
Sister, elder sister.
And even now also.
I see.
Even today, these
which
days
is not done in Goa so
much. So maybe other days, but we call for any days, even the elder person we call with respect.
Yeah.
Not in Hindus, not in first term.
I see.
Yeah.
How?
Means Tumi.
Yeah. Yeah. Plural. Plural.
To,
yeah.
Plural means
in Konkani it's not there. No,
it's not. In Konkani is there, but because of Portuguese influence, this has changed to like in English you have only you.
Yeah.
There is a.
Dao is gone.
It's something that even now also we address our seniors with respect. And the elders we call them Irma, Mana, even to this day.
Yeah.
Even brother-in-law Kunyat, uncle we call Tiva. Again, here Bahmans call Tiva, Tados call Kaka.
In the, among the Badeskars?
Yeah, among Badeskars.
I see.
So, and so many things.
The caste system is still prevalent?
It was there till 1980. It's quite strong. They never stayed in same village. Though they used to attend in same
church.
Chapel or church.
Yeah.
But afterwards there was no social mingling at all.
Yeah.
There was no marriage. They were not mixing at all. But after 1975-80, because of the efforts of some priests,
I see.
It has changed. Maybe social reasons also compelled them to have intermarriage. Otherwise, they used to never stay in the same village.
I see.
The distance between the two villages used to be hardly 3 or 4 kilometers.
Yeah.
But they wanted to
keep their identity.
Separate identity and not to reveal with the Hindu neighbors.
I see. Not
so,
to?
So reveal these differences.
Not to reveal?
These differences are common on top of it.
Hindu. Okay. So it was like a well-kept secret?
Yeah, well-kept secret.
I see.
But they used to never marry. Hardly they used to meet for a lunch or a date.
Yeah.
They used to meet together in the church.
Yeah.
But they used to have to take a health ticket. So I feel after 1667, it's migration, but in very small number.
It's a very fascinating story because it's a story that people in Goa have not understood or have forgotten or have not taken the trouble to study.
I think they have not taken trouble to study.
Yeah.
And what happened because of economic reasons, they were even the Badeskars, what we call, they were not, they had no facility of education. Again, I here repeat, the conflict between the Padroado and propaganda made this difference.
I see.
St. Paul's was there from 1856 and most of the villages are within 25-30 kilometer radius of Belgaum. But no, they were not taken in their fold because they were under propaganda and all the things. And maybe
St. Paul's was a propaganda school?
Yeah, propaganda school. And only in 1890 Jesuits came, that too from
Spain.
Spain, Portugal,
okay.
This. That time invited. There were no Portuguese Jesuits in Goa.
Yeah.
They came
direct to Belgaum.
Belgaum. From Bombay.
From Bombay.
From Bombay.
Bombay was under the Spanish Jesuits, I think, no?
No, it was...
German?
It was German.
German.
German. A lot of evangelization was done through in Ahmednagar and other districts.
Okay. German Jesuits.
German Jesuits. And maybe with the request from Archbishop of Goa or things, so Jesuits sent the first team somewhere in 1890. That two or three this came to Belgaum. Again, they had problem of language because those people wanted English, where these people were
concerned
with Portuguese. So, maybe because of this, these people remain away from the proper education.
What is the size of the Bhadeskar community today, wherever scattered all over the world?
All over the world, it may be around 80 to 90,000.
Really?
Yeah.
So,
but in Belgaum diocese, there are around 35,000. But they are scattered. See, some part comes under Samantwadi diocese.
Yeah.
Because of wedding laws and other things.
Yeah.
And most of them have migrated to places like Pune, Bombay, Bangalore nowadays.
Tell us something about the Goan community in Pune. We were just talking about it. So, what would be their numbers?
Pune has a very strong influence of Goan Portuguese. Mostly because of the Britishers, because of the railway, post, ammunition factory.
I see. Migration from Goa.
From Goa. But much before that, first community of Goans is from 1785.
Where they were given granted land for a church. And
That is the church was built. It's called IC Church or Goichi Igrej or City Church it is called. It was built in 1792.
With a grant from the Marathas.
From the Maratha Peshwas. Because when Mingal Narona was in charge of armory in Peshwa's services, and along with him there were many Goan soldiers. So he requested Peshwas to grant a piece of land and some help to have a chapel. So the chapel was built in that place.
Amazing, amazing. So Pune Goan Institute is in that same locality?
Same campus.
Same campus.
Yeah.
On the same land?
Yeah. So from that time onwards, Goan presence is there. Of course, in 1818, Marathas lost power, Britishers came over there, and they might have found Goan more akin to their culture. And so they were given jobs, petty jobs like that. And then with the ammunition factory, postal department, railways, many Goan found the job. So there was a constant migration from that time onwards.
And what's the number now?
It should be around 55 to 60,000 of Goan origin.
I see. Amazing.
Yeah.
So you are basically an engineer. How this interest in history?
Oh, maybe that is, I was curious to know about my roots.
It's very normal, and there's nothing odd in that sense.
Then I just another thing happened is Khanapur is a strong Catholic presence.
Really?
Yeah.
Relatively,
because the Sharon de Cruz book.
Yeah.
There is a paragraph she mentions that in 1739. 2,500 people took shelter in Kittur Chennamma's kingdom.
Kittur Chennamma, the local queen.
Yeah, local queen. And Kittur is hardly 10-12 kilometers from Khanapur. Kittur was a small kingdom.
Of course, all these are places which we only hear of when taking the Goa bus to Belgaum.
Yeah, correct. So Khanapur and surrounding villages, there are many presence of Catholics there. And in fact, there are 2-3 villages near Khanapur where there are 100% Catholics are there.
100%?
Yeah.
Which villages?
Bhosgali is there. Presently around 50 families are there. Next to that is Mansapur. Almost 60 to 70% people are Catholics.
I see.
Then Sangargadi, almost 60% are Catholics. Then another place nearby, I can't take out the name.
Yeah.
There are, they have again same. It is called Nauga. The place of the village is called Nauga. So they have two separate this. One is only fully Catholic,
yeah.
Other neighboring and particularly the Hindus.
Yeah.
So that way it is just surrounding Kanpur.
Right.
And in 2000 they celebrated 400 years of arrival of Catholics.
Okay.
In fact, many people came to Pune to collect the data. It was a big fair. Many, when Pundlik Nayak, the Fellero, and all the people, Bernard D'Souza, all they went over there. I didn't go, though I was called, but
yeah.
It was on 1st January, they celebrated 400 years. Then after a few months of this year...
Then debate started.
No, then I just wrote to Father Joe Pinto, who was a parish priest. Do you have any record? Because what if 600 years means much before, 30 years before Shivaji was born.
Okay. Okay. And there's no reason for Goans to have gone there so early.
So early, or if they have gone, then you have any record.
Yeah.
Like maybe priest diary.
Yeah.
Or maybe some baptism record or something. So after 5-6 days, he replied, we don't have. And even I am not sure whether they have... come in 1600,
yeah.
But that time because of millennium celebration,
yeah.
Somebody put that
suggestion.
So even Bishop agreed, and we
okay.
had it. Because by the time I had read book by Father Hull,
yeah.
on Bombay Mission History, there he had mentioned 1650 onward there is a migration from Goa because of various reasons. Okay. And how 1600 means there should be something. And then again, while studying, I found that Christianization started only after 1600 in Valdez.
I see.
Whereas they were very much familiar with Portuguese and Catholic
culture already. When they reached there.
Irmão, Mana, nothing.
Yeah.
If they were first generation, they must have...
They would have gone more with the Indian culture in that
or
sense.
Or they would have gone to that religion also.
Yeah.
But they were very much stout Catholics.
I see.
Even to
the, they continue to be.
Yeah. So that again helped me to find out when okay. actually they came.
So that's what intrigued your mind also.
Yes.
So, Mr. Montero, what's the state of the community today? Because we were privileged to go on a tour taken by Mr. Edward Falero yeah. and Bernard Souza, yeah. Advocate Bernard Souza, yeah. who is a part of the yeah. community and has played a big role in yeah. South Goa.
Yeah.
You know, at first level, it's a bit shocking because you find people who look absolutely Indic, absolutely Indian, absolutely
yeah.
Hindu even.
Yeah. Yeah.
And to our mind, a Catholic fits into a different stereotype. No? So they'll be sari clad.
Yeah, yeah. See, what happened?
Nose ring.
Prior to 1970 or 1950, when you village level, they used to wear dhoti.
I see.
Then
topi.
Not topi, patka.
Feta.
Feta.
Everything is different. No?
It's
a different name.
Afterwards, some educated, they were shifted to topi that way. Ladies used to wear the sari. And this not only, which was my very different, but in Bangalore also I've observed that,
yeah.
older generation, because my neighbors in Pune,
yeah.
For some wedding, their elder brother had come.
Yeah.
He was wearing dhoti.
I see.
Yeah, and coat.
Coat.
Then... I had my neighbors in Belgaum camp area, one Albuquerque family from Bangalore, and their parents, they were educated but used to wear dhoti, coat and a black cap. So only in Goa...
Yeah, the westernization was at a very, very high degree.
So after until 1960s or 1950s, very few people got the education because in vernacular language, Marathi or Kannada in south of there.
Yeah.
That too, if it was school was available, even my father or my father's cousins, somewhere in 1925, they were sent for schooling to a place called Daddi, which was almost 15 kilometers away from our hometown, Tiruwadi.
Wow.
One reason is that my ancestors were that way quite well to do, and why not Belgaum? Belgaum was 120 kilometers because they were tilling the land of Saukars of Daddi. So that may be one reason they were sent to Daddi with one lady with a house. They were staying there. They passed out 7th standard,
which was a lot here in
yeah.
those days.
But for other people, education was not possible.
Yeah. Yeah.
And we started. First Marathi medium school was started by Jesuit in Belgundi, a town around 15 kilometers away from Belgaum. that time it was there for 5-6 years, then afterwards the school was closed down.
What are the main issues the community faces today?
Actually, my community is very well assimilated with local Hindus.
Yeah.
They are not discriminated, because they are very much
assimilated
with that
and accepted.
So they haven't faced discrimination as such.
Okay.
But because of lack of education, but English education, they couldn't prosper further.
Okay.
They couldn't get jobs.
Right.
And this started only after 1957. Jesuit opened the Sarvoday High School in Khanapur, boarding school.
I see.
And the priest, Father, Edmund D'Souza, he used to go to village to village.
I see.
Send your people, if you don't have money, don't pay.
I see.
Give me paddy when you cultivate. That way.
Okay, okay. Pay in kind.
Yeah,
pay in kind.
Pay in kind if you don't have, but send your children.
Yeah.
He even went to almost 30-40 kilometers around same time, maybe around 71-72. Father Job De Silva from Azre, which is the northern part, diocesan priest, he started a school. He also had same problem at a boarding school. So with that, the children got English medium school.
Basically rural life in that sense. No? It's a challenge too.
Challenge.
And these are vast areas, no?
Yeah, vast areas,
not
spread out.
Spread out, not well connected with transport, and only now things are changing.
Yeah, changing.
Youngsters have migrated all over the world?
Yeah, you can say now, because of the IT industry and all things. Now, even my two sons, my elder one is in Singapore, and younger one is in Canada.
I saw them at the book release.
Yeah, correct.
So what is the future of the community, the identity? You think your book, I also feel your book would cement an understanding of the community?
Yeah, it should definitely help me. At least it is sort of a first documentation about this migration. Of course, there was one book written by Father Valent Fernandez, but he wrote a small book as a study of his theology thesis.
I see.
Yeah. And that I read it in, it was in English by Vidyajyoti in Delhi, but it was translated in Marathi.
Just one last question. Tell us what are the chapters your book has.
Chapters is that, just it has given first brief history of Goa, means which part where, old conquest, new conquest.
Portuguese colonization and
And why we are called Bardeskars, because when our ancestors are from where you have come, that time Goa had no separate identity, they used to call Bardes.
Idea of Goa was not yet crystallized properly.
Crystallized,
So we are Bardes. We are
Bardes. So they used to call Bardeskar.
Okay.
That way I got name. But surprisingly, if you go to Khanapur and further south, towards Karwar, which are on the ghat, they don't call themselves Bardeskar. Though they are from Bardes, they get zoned from all the way there. They are called Kokne. Kokne.
Kokne.
In Goa,
which in Goa has a different meaning.
Yeah,
Kokne is a Hindu.
Yeah. But there, Kokne means Catholics.
Catholics. Kokne, it means Catholics.
Yeah.
Konkani speaking Catholics.
So they are called Kokne.
Okay.
They don't call themselves Bardeskar.
Okay, okay, okay.
But they are from Bardes.
Yeah. Same roots. And then?
Then next one is the. Then I have given well brief history. Then second thing, probable reasons and period of migration. There I have gone in detail.
Yeah.
Means what are the probable period and reasons.
Yeah.
Because many church historians have given famine and pandemic is one of the reasons. And they have given also mentioned about the wars. And wars with Bijapur, Marathas, and Inquisition is the last this. But that I have tried to sort it out. Pandemic or famine is not the reason.
Okay.
The reason I specified over there that almost 90% people are from the upper caste, from the upper crest of the Goan community.
Migrants.
Yeah, migrants. They are from Barman and Tardo. They get zoned.
Yeah.
They are not from
they are members,
or
yeah, they are members of the comunidad there.
So if it is a famine, they would have come back after a year or two. Because they have land, they have property, other things. Same thing with pandemic. Because even now also we see people with very meager means, or those who don't have land holding, they migrate during such period.
Right.
So I don't think my people migrated because of these reasons. Yes, there are two prominent reasons is war with Maratha and with Inquisition. War with Maratha also not because of fear of Maratha, because some records show that they invited Marathas to fight against
the Portuguese.
And another thing is that in 1675, many people don't know that Inquisition Center was installed or erected at Aldona.
I see.
And what happened, because of mere of fear itself, people must have fled.
Hmm.
But there are no these two prominent reasons.
Do your reasons tally with Alan's arguments? Because he's studying the migration to Mangalore, no?
Yeah. It is, see, what happened? It is more or less same from 1680 onwards.
Yeah.
Mangalorean Catholics migration started.
Also from Bardis?
From Bardis.
Not Salset.
Salset also, some people went from Salset. It was more there.
I see.
See what happened? Christianization in Salset and Ilas took place much earlier than Bardis.
Right.
So, from 1560 or 1575 onwards, Christianization started with Jesuits in command at Salset.
Yeah.
And maybe after a few years of some fear or fright of Inquisition, they must have left, maybe some taxation or thing. They didn't face much war problems
compared to Bardis. Hmm. And then?
And then while going through the Franciscan mission history by Dr. Sharon DeCruz.
Yeah, her PhD thesis, which is online.
And it is quite voluminous. Yeah. But she specifically mentioned 2,500 people in 1739 migrated to Kittur.
Yeah.
It was a neighboring Abadha Ghats. And presently most of the Goan Catholics are nearby that area.
I see.
So that some written
reasons, the documentation is there.
Documentation is there. For earlier, there is no documentation.
I see.
Yeah.
Interesting. What is the other chapters of your book?
Then I have tried to give the cultural aspects or traditions
of the community.
Of our community. Like Almachi Javon, Rose, Know This, means after death. We celebrate 9 days. Now it has come to with the priest availability 7 days, 3rd day, I think. But earlier used to have 9 day service. People used to, because close relatives to stay there, and then after 9 day meals, they used to go. Away. We have certain this like sanna during wedding time or the feast time. We make sanna, which is again part of Goan cuisine.
Yeah.
Then during month of August we have pato leaves.
Yeah.
Turmeric leaves. These are the Then we have Sanjav on 24th June.
I see.
But it is much different than what we see on media about Goa.
Okay.
It is much of a fun making.
Wells? Jumping into the wells?
Jumping in, but it's not there in
No.
So there it is something different. There on 24th June, young married couple comes to
parents' house, in-law, parents.
Not in-law's house. Immediately after marriage in April, May, they used to be with the in-law's house.
Yeah.
They used to work in the fields.
I see.
And after monsoon, first week of June monsoon, it was a relaxed period.
Yeah.
So that time, they used to come to the bride's house,
okay,
including husband.
Okay.
And for 2-3 days, used to be there on that 24th June, they used to make some special dish called
pude
with the
jackfruit leaves.
Yes, jackfruit leaves and all the things.
Yeah, this
thing. Then the sister-in-law, the brother-in-law, used to make fun of the brother-in-law.
Okay.
They used to make special dish. After 3-4 days, they used to go back.
Okay.
But there was no
jumping in the
jumping bells. In this. Then we have, which I have written in detail, is about Irsas. Irsas are the lyrics which they sing right from Miss Almaje Jawan, Lovos, Rishi Man.
It would be fun to record that, no? Before it
dies actually out. Wanted. So actually I tried to almost 60 to 70 Irsas I have written down.
Yeah.
This is another...
you spelled as Y-E-R-S? Y-E-R-S?
Y-E-R-S-A.
Essay.
I mean, actually C with...
Yeah, C Cirilla, yeah.
Yeah, so we call it Irsa.
Yeah,
That is actually sung by the ladies.
Okay.
I am surprised when I go read this or when I collected this, that they have given reference of Goa.
I see.
Means...
so the memories have remained in those songs
this,
over hundreds of years.
Generation to generation, and those are illiterate ladies.
I see.
None of them.
And they have not read.
Yeah, they have just passed on from generation to generation. Then flowers like Aboli, Zai, Zui.
Are sung about.
Yeah.
You don't have them there?
No, not much.
I see.
In some part we get, but those we have.
Okay, the cultural images and specificities have still continued.
Yeah. Then. Mapsha Jigra, some references, Rayata Neta, some references are there. But with first few Irsas are devotional ones, thanking our lady and everything. Then fun making also of the groom or this. Or, and then what happened next day of the wedding or the nuptials.
Yeah.
Early morning time there used to be a sort of a duet.
I see.
The husband's group and bride's group.
It's a kind of a challenge in song.
Challenge in song. Yeah, duet. To pull the legs and all the thing. And then they used to have a dhoti che jevan.
Dhoti.
Dhoti means...
Dowry. Dowry. No, of course, there is a distinction between dhot. It's some kind of, it's not exactly dowry, it's some kind of a...
No, no, what happened?
Share of the bride.
No, gold, then clothes or whatever.
Dhot is today translated as dowry, but it is like a bride share of the family property or something.
But that is...
it's so, close to dowry.
So, they used to display.
Yeah.
In modern times.
Yeah.
Now, it has almost...
Correct. Very, and it's also illegal and against the law.
Yeah.
And all
that. So, dhoti che jawan means there used to be lunch and then... People used to disperse.
I see.
After then, it's called Partavne.
Partavne, the return, return.
Yeah, return for 3 or 4 days with a bride's house.
I see.
Then again, there used to be rose.
I see.
Is there.
Yeah.
But now it is almost there. Then there is another part called this with Gumta. Even Goa so some parts even now they have Gumta. It is again men's domain, you can say, like Irsa is for the ladies, whereas this also they sing padas,
poems, songs.
Like it is a
Kantar, what we call Kantar, Marathi.
It is a Sanskrit oriented word, pad means, and Irsa has come from various sounds. It means a sort of a Kantar or something.
Yeah, Portuguese.
Whereas Pad is there.
Yeah.
But now that is also diminishing or it is vanishing. Only few villages in Khanapur area have that. So that also I want to collect in my next edition. Because this is a traditional thing.
Yeah.
And maybe after a few years...
It will die out. It could die out.
It will die out. And this also, for this Irsas also... I sponsored some sort of a competition in Uzwad magazine from Belgaum.
I see.
I gave them...
So Uzwad is a mouthpiece of the Bardeskars?
Bardeskars, yeah.
In Kannada script, Konkani?
No, it is Devanagari script.
Devanagari script. Yeah.
Because our people are familiar with...
It's Marathi.
Marathi. So Devanagari script is...
Is easier for yours.
Yeah. Only few pockets south...
South it becomes Kannada script.
Kannada. But most of them again...
The dialect might be slightly different.
Slightly different. Even... I have given that slightly. Even among Brahman and Thado also there is a slight
dialectical. Dialectical.
Yes.
Some choice of words, especially.
Yeah. That is there.
Thank you. Thank you so much for all your time. Yes. Nice to have you sharing, and I hope that
Thank you.
I hope that the community has understood more, studied more, and has a sense of history and retains it because it's so important, no?
Yeah. I'm glad that after education facilities, after 60s or 70s. And then another institute which helped mostly in the Lower Strang is St. Joseph Technical Institute in Pune.
I see.
The Jesuit,
really?
The German Jesuits who started an ITS sort of course.
I see.
So after SSC, all these boys came to Pune.
I see.
And because after completing the ITI course, they got jobs in various industries. And most of them have now
done
flourished.
Well. I see.
Well, means yes, many have started their own units. Some have become a big post in foreign companies. Then after the 70s, 80s, earlier, even Goa Liberation helped many Goans because what happened in 61, they wanted, Bandodkar's they wanted to teach Marathi.
Yeah.
So most of the
earlier
generation,
came
as a teacher.
Really?
Yeah, there are, I think, during 61 to 65, maybe at least 50 to 60 people
really?
Came here.
As they, teachers.
Most of them, given that Dr. Jerome Mandura, I told, his father came as a teacher.
I see. Interesting.
Then,
interesting.
Relative,
interesting. Unintended consequences of history.
Yeah. And what happened, it was an added advantage. Because they knew Marathi.
Yeah.
They wanted to, and they also knew Konkani.
Yeah. I see.
So they had an advantage.
Languages, of course, always an asset.
So that was an advantage. And afterwards, Pune, Bombay, Bangalore, because of the industries, they got jobs of ITI. Then again, some communities, I mean, some people studied further.
Yeah.
What happened now, while I was just going through the history, in 60s, there were many Goans in defense services, IAS and other things.
Military also.
Military also in defense services, Mangaloreans, even Goans.
Yeah.
But after 1990 or 2000, hardly anyone
I
is
see.
There.
In government.
In government. Because there are various reasons.
Yeah.
Because they had an advantage of English education. Yeah. Very few used to participate for UPSC and PSC. But among Bajaskas, now after passing out MPSC, they are in big post. One retired as an IAS officer in Maharashtra.
I see.
Other one is a RTO chief of Kolhapur.
I see.
MPSC.
These were the earlier people who joined in the earlier batch, you're saying?
Yeah, means who passed out in 70s, 80s.
Okay.
Then they passed out, they attended competitive exam.
Okay.
One is a joint commissioner of GST in Bombay.
I see.
His name is Pereira.
Interesting. Interesting.
Not Pereira, Alvarez.
Okay.
David Alvarez.
Okay.
His brother is the RTO chief of Kolhapur. So very soon he'll.
Education can make a difference.
Yeah. So many people joined in defense services.
Yeah.
They are retired as a squadron leader.
I see.
And in military also, lieutenant colonel.
I see. Interesting.
This of my generation, we can say.
Yeah.
Or after that.
Yeah.
And then only thing is that just 3 years back or 4 years back, first Bajaskar passed out from NDA.
I see.
That is the first you can say.
I see. National Defense Academy.
Yeah. Now he is a fighter pilot.
I see. Interesting. What's his name?
His name is Rego.
Rego.
Their parents write as a Reggae.
I see.
Because what happened from my hometown, Nisri, because Rego and Reggae was very
close. Okay.
Because Reggae is a typical Maharashtrian Saraswat Brahmin.
Yeah.
Origin from Goa.
Yeah.
So there, Rego.
Interesting.
Because there we have like a Kuris, like Cruz.
Yeah.
The Cruz.
Some names get a little bit spelled differently.
Yeah.
Because of the British and Indian influence.
No, or
when they registered.
Yeah. Souza. Like now they are writing D'Souza, but earlier Souza was a common thing.
Correct.
Souza.
Today I have even seen D'Souza, D apostrophe, S small, S-O-U-Z-A in that sense. Or D'Souza is one word without apostrophe.
That happens.
That happens.
But in earlier records, Portuguese record used to be
Souza.
Cruz.
Yeah. And some are spelt as they are pronounced in that sense, no?
Yeah.
Because the Portuguese spelling is different.
Yeah.
So
now Mendonça.
Yeah.
For Narona, we have Narona, but now earlier it was Norens.
I see.
Norenj.
How you spell it?
Norenj.
I see.
Actually, in Portuguese, J or this Y.
Y. Naranja, something, whatever it is.
So,
interesting, very interesting.
Yeah.
On that note, thank you so much, Mr. Montero. It's a pleasure talking to you.
It's a pleasure.
I hope this records well and comes out well. Thank you.